Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you all can hear me. So shall we start off from where we left last week? So last week we were looking at Colombo Stock Exchange specifically. Then we went through how the stock exchange is structured. We have two components, the CDS, Central Depository Systems Private Limited, looking into the post-trade area where they look into the securities depository services. And then you have Lanka Clear, who does the clearing and the settlement as a central counterparty. These were the key functions of these two entities. Then we saw what were the products that are to be traded and are traded in the CSC. So if you can recall here, let's go back to our screen since that's easier to work on. So if you take this particular image, so this tells you what the Colombo Stock Exchange is offering at the moment, the products. So out of that, currently what do we have? We have the LKR denominated equity shares. We have warrants. We have close-ended funds, I showed you. And then we have the corporate debt. These four broader products are available. Remember, under LKR denominated equity shares, you have ordinary, under ordinary, you have voting, non-voting. All the types fall under this broad category. Okay, so we have ordinary shares, then you have the voting and the non-voting. And if there are preference shares, those will also fall under this broad area. But these are the broad products that are being catered by the CSE at the moment. But what are they looking into launching within the Colombo Stock Exchange? They're looking into multi-currency equities. We saw that they have already a separate board called the multi-currency board. Then you have real estate investment trust that they're looking at. They're also looking into exchange traded funds. And these three are the products that they are hoping to launch and expand on. Okay, so understand that. So this was a recent article that they were working on the real estate investment trust being launched. Read up on that. So the CSE is actively looking into expanding that segment. Then we moved into the main board. The separate boards that the Colombo Stock Exchange has for a company, if they want to list in, what kind of a board or a category that they could select to be listed in. So the main or the prime board available is the main board, where we saw the threshold levels are very high. They're expecting a more larger scale and established company to be listed under the main board. And then you have the Dirisavi board. Dirisavi board looks into a relatively smaller segment, smaller scale companies, but not SME specifically. You can see its stated capital has to be not less than 100 million. So you can't say SMEs fall into this. You could say a medium scale or a emerging company could get listed under this segment. Then you have two new boards coming in, multi-currency board, and then you have the Empower board. Multi-currency board is available for the foreign companies, but here, remember, it's a secondary listing that happens in the multi-currency board. If it's a foreign company, it's a requirement for that particular company to be a listed entity in their own country of incorporation. First, that needs to be done. It is after that they could come to Sri Lanka and get listed under the multi-currency board and understand the limitations that they have. Investing and trading in such shares are only permitted to the non-resident investors. But they should also, if it's non-resident investors, they also should operate through a local custodian bank. So remember that. Then we looked into the separate criteria available, and I explained you in detail why such criteria are available, so that the stock exchange can ensure that a quality, a strong security is being listed in that exchange. And then you have the Empower Board, which looks into the SME category. So there we could see the threshold levels are very flexible, very low. And there were some novel thresholds being put in, such as the total assets. Total assets should be maximum of 600. It can be 600 or below. All right. So that will help them to understand and identify the SME segment market. And then we also saw that if it's a SME company looking into being listed into the Empower Board, they need to submit their applications through a sponsor. So we saw that the sponsors were mainly investment banks who will help the company structure their facility or structure the particular issue. So that's why CSE wants them to come through a sponsor, because those companies might not be aware about the stock exchange, what the expectations of the investors. So to guide them, then this CSE requires such companies to couple with a sponsor. Let's see if I could get the note. Yes. So in the note, I would have given you a detailed summary. So by just looking at one single slide of it, you can look at all the requirements available. It helps you to contrast between the requirements and study at once. If you have any doubts, yes. So here you can see the main criteria. All four boards, definitely they have a criteria on stated capital, and they definitely have a criteria on the positive net assets. Why? Because we understand this is the stock exchange that we're looking at. They want stronger companies to be listed in the stock exchange. Remember, if you have weaker companies or companies which can be collapsed, what happens? It will affect the stock exchange, affect the investors. Therefore, the confidence of the investors toward the stock exchange will be lost. That's one of the main reasons why the stock exchange has such listing requirements. They want to ensure that a good quality, good governance, good quality and good stronger securities are being listed in the stock exchange. Okay. So irrespective of the type of the board, they definitely have a requirement on stated capital and positive net assets. Positive net assets essentially talks about the equity of the company. Now, stated capital, we know, is the issued shares into the par value. It's just one component of equity. The next one is they look at the overall equity. So there you have stated capital and you will have some retained earnings also being added on and some reserves as well. So you can have a company which has a good stated capital, but when you look at the equity, it can be negative. Why? The retained loss or the accumulated loss is so huge that it has surpassed the stated capital amount. So in that scenario, you will end up with a negative net assets. So to ensure that on both levels that this company is strong is why you have a stated capital requirement and a positive net asset requirement. I'll try to show it you through a stock exchange. Let's take two companies. You hope they have their financials still listed here. So if you look at John Keel's, let's see. So this is the consolidated statement of financial position. So here, I hope you can see it clearly. Sorry. So stated capital, this is what we're looking at the moment. Stated capital, and then the positive net assets is ideally total assets minus the liability. So that will give you the total equity. So this has to be positive. There is no any value requirement, if you can see. There was no any value requirement. They just want it to be positive, and they have given number of years that it needs to be positive. Remember that there is a particular number requirement for the stated capital. But when it comes to positive net assets, what the stock exchange wants, it has to be positive, and they give you particular number of years that it has to be positive. Okay, so here you can see that requirement is available. If I recall, this company doesn't have that requirement. Okay, here you can see this company has a positive stated capital. Okay, but once it comes to the total equity, you can see it's not positive, it's negative. The accumulated loss is so big that it has surpassed the stated capital amount. So to prevent such companies to be entering into the stock exchange is why they have a control on both requirements. So then you have the next is what they worry about, the profitability, whether the company is a profit-making company. So for them to impose a criteria on profitability, the company has to be established. You can't expect an SME or emerging company to record profits consecutively. Understand? Therefore, for a main board and a multi-currency board, they have the profitability threshold imposed. But what happens is when you move to the Dirisavi and the Empower board, because it's difficult for them to impose a profitability requirement, they move to an operating history requirement. I hope you can see here. So main board doesn't have operating history, but they have a profitability requirement. Dirisavi the other way. So whoever who doesn't have a profitability has a operating history requirement. All right. So that's how the basically it's a mirror effect. So these will help you to understand when they give you a MCQ to pick up the requirement. You can argue, and at least if you can't remember the particular threshold even, you can argue and understand what kind of a requirement is available for that particular board. All right. So all these minimum public shareholding so far has been stipulated for the conventional boards that we have at the moment. So all these will help you analyze and understand the requirements in one shot. So ideally go through this particular summary. So today we are going to start off with the debt listing. So we know in the Colombo Stock Exchange, not only shares, you also have debentures being listed, the debt. Remember, corporate debt is also one of the products. So if those are to be listed, what are the requirements available is the summary here. So here, first we are going to look at if it's a government entity, what is the requirement? If it's a government or a government related entity, what would be the requirement? So basically, if it's a government entity, what the stock exchange expects from them is for them to be eligible enough to get into to list a debenture or a debt instrument in the stock exchange, they want them to provide an unconditional and an irrevocable undertaking. Now, understand these two words are different. Unconditional meaning, that particular guarantee should not have any condition. It should be erased free from condition to honor the claim. Other one is it's irrevocable, meaning once you give the guarantee, the giving entity cannot recall it during the tenure. Understand? So that's why they use two words, unconditional and irrevocable guarantee. So they expect the guarantee from, first of all, the main in party, government of Sri Lanka, or a bank licensed by the CBSL, and that particular bank should have a rating, or at least an equivalent rating by a rating agency registered with the CSE. Now today, when we study about Securities and Exchange Commission, you will understand why rating agency is registered with them or not. But for now, remember, all rating agencies are registered at the Securities and Exchange Commission. So only when they are registered, they are capable to give out rating for the listed companies. So here the one requirement is, first of all, if it's an unconditional and irrevocable guarantee for a government entity or a related government entity like a public corporation, the very first expectation is they expect like a guarantee from the government of Sri Lanka, or a bank licensed by the CBSL, but that particular bank should have an A rating by a rating agency registered on the CSE. Next is where you have, if you can't get from both of those two, a international or a multilateral or a bilateral agency who can come in and guarantee on the repayment for the capital and the interest. If all these three is unable to be received, and if the debt security, the security you're trying to list, has an investment grade rating by the rating agency, still that particular government entity can go ahead. So at this moment itself, remember, if it's a government entity, the main requirement is an unconditional and an irrevocable guarantee. It has to be either from the government of Sri Lanka or a bank. But if it's a bank, what is the specific requirement? It has to be licensed by CBSL1 and has to be A-rated or equivalent rating by a rating agency registered by the CSE. That is important. Or any international, multilateral or bilateral agency who is willing to guarantee on the repayment of the capital and interest, okay, both. If these three cannot be done with, then the particular debt security that you're trying to list should have an investment grade rating by the rating agency registered with the CSE. So two components, if you can meet either of them, they can go ahead and get listed for the debt issue. But what happens if it's a company, like a private entity coming in? What is their eligibility criteria? Now, can you ask a guarantee? Can you mandate a guarantee? No. Therefore, it's an option that is available. The primary requirement for a private entity is, if you're coming into listing your debt, okay, then definitely they expect mandatory rating for the debt security. The debt security has to be rated. That is requirement number one. And then it's an and. Now here you can see it's all any three of them can do it. But here, first one, the security has to be rated. That is a mandatory requirement. And that rating should be one notch above the investment grade. Now that is important. For a government entity, CSE is willing to go ahead with the investment grade rating. So investment grade rating is BBB or above. All right. So when it comes to private entity, they are not willing to go ahead with investment grade only. They want at least one notch above the investment grade. So one notch above meaning it can't be triple B, it has to be triple B plus. The minimum grading that they can willing to accept is a triple B plus. Understand? So that is important. This, if you can highlight it, sorry. It has to be rated. It has to be rated. And the other one is the rating should have one notch above the investment grade. So when they say one notch, just one standing above the basic bare minimum of the investment grade. Additionally, if the entity, if the private company wants, they can go ahead with a guarantee. Again, it has to be unconditional and irrevocable. But remember, the same three entities is where CSE would actually accept guarantees from. But because it's a private company, can they go to the government of Sri Lanka? Can't. So that is out. Then the other two entities come in. It has to be a bank. It has to be a bank licensed by CBSL and have a rating of A or equal by a rating agency registered with the SCC or international, multilateral or bilateral agency who's willing to guarantee on the capital and the interest. Okay, so understand. For a government entity, they are willing because it's a government entity, they perceive a lesser risk. So what they say is the main criteria is we need a guarantee from the government of Sri Lanka. If it's a bank, it has to be licensed by CBSL and should have a rating of A or equal, or from an international, multilateral or bilateral agency. Who's willing to guarantee on both the capital and interest repayment. If not, they could go ahead with the debt security, but the debt security should be listed with the investment grade rating. It is either of these, but one of these should be there. For an applicant entity who is private, the mandatory requirement is the rating of the debt security. What they want is it has to be rated and the rating has to be one notch above the investment grade. Additionally, on its own discretion, if the company is willing, they could go ahead with a guarantee. But who are the guarantee parties available? Government of Sri Lanka is not available and the other two could come in and give a guarantee. Now, practically what happens is if you have a private entity, who is unable to fulfill the first requirement. What is the first requirement? They are unable to get a rating, or they can get a rating from the rating on the issue, but that particular rating is not one notch above the investment grade. Let's say it's a triple B or triple B minus. So when they are lacking to fulfill the main criteria, what they would have to do is they would have to couple it with a guarantee. You can go ahead even though if it's below the investment grade or at triple B even, but they have to couple it with the guarantee that they have mentioned below. Okay, if you satisfy the very first requirement, you don't need the guarantee. That's your discretion. But if you fail to address the main requirement, then you will have to couple it with the guarantee to go ahead to the market. And another thing that most of the companies, what they practically do is, now they go opinion shopping, that you say it's they get rated by two or three agencies, so they can pick the rating that is favorable from them. So what TSC does or SCC does to prevent such opinion shopping, or you know, to manipulate and put out only the favorable rating, is if a private entity gets their issue rated from more than one rating agencies, Okay, you have so more than one rating agency rates your particular issue. So you will have different ratings. If you have different ratings, that come, what would the company prefer? I would, as a company, I would want to go for the best rating. Now, let's imagine there are three rating agencies. One agency is giving me A+. The other one is giving me BBB. And another one is giving me BBB+. So I would want to go with the A+ rated agency. Why? My issue is better rated there. But what, as a regulator, what does the CSE or the SEC's requirement is? No, if you're getting it rated by more than one rating agency, then the lowest rating has to be picked. So this will enable and safeguard the investors from being misled. Okay, so in the same scenario, what would the CSE or the SEC want me to do? They will say, no, your lowest is a BBB, so that's your rating. You cannot go ahead with the listing of your debt. Why? BBB is not one notch above the investment grade. It's the bare minimum of the investment grade. Okay, so that's how they restrict or safeguard and ensure that a quality security gets listed in the stock exchange. Now, these two are the only differing criteria when it comes to debt. Depending on the ownership of the issuing company, the eligibility criteria is different. You can understand that. But what are the common debt related common requirements? So here what they have is, if it's a minimum tenor, all debt securities has to have a minimum tenor of 2 years from the date of issuance. Now you must be wondering, why minimum two? Now remember, when we studied money market and capital market, I'll do my drawing here. So we understood, remember, if it's 1 year and less, it is money market related. If it's more, then it becomes capital market related. Okay, so for a debt to be fallen into the Colombo Stock Exchange, which is a capital market, can you have minimum tenor of 1 year? No, it has to be a minimum tenor of 2 years, which falls into the minimum tenor requirement. At least it has to be two. It can be more than two, the capital market is fine with it. But the bare minimum when it comes to the tenor is 2 years. Now, this is irrespective of the issuing entity, whether it's a government or a private, whatever it is, the security that they are listing has to have a minimum tenor of 2 years. Minimum tenor of 2 years, it's not the residual tenor that they're talking about, but from the date you issue the security, it has to have a 2 year tenor. So when you're writing it in your exam, don't just write minimum of 2 years, write it properly, mentioning 2 years from the date of issuance. Okay, because don't give half baked answers. The in full one is 2 years from the date of issuance. And the other is par value for it to be listed in the CSC is 100 rupees. And the minimum subscription is 10,000 and in multiples of 10,000. And the other requirement is, I hope you can see. And the minimum requirement is, if it's an entity who has their securities, already issued securities in the watch list category, then such companies or entities cannot issue debt securities. Now, what is this watch list? In the CSC, what they do is they have certain guidelines or certain regulations that the listed entities should follow on. They have deadlines to issue your financial statements, annual and quarterly. Then you have criteria of minimum public holding that you need to register for. If your particular financial statements has an adverse audit opinion after you get listed. I'm talking about, okay, after you get listed, if you don't give your financials on time, or if something happens and your auditor has given a very adverse opinion or a qualified opinion, then CSC could temporarily put you in this category called watch list. It's a temporary category. If you continue to do it, they will transfer you to a board called default board. We will have discussed that later. Next slide would be having that. If you prolong stay in the watch list, they will move you to the default board. Watch list is like, remember, the CSC is monitoring you. They are watching you. You have breached the criteria. So they are giving you time to address this issue. So if you can address it, you can get out of the watch list and be regularly trading. If not, you're under the watch list category. This is just to prevent from any listed entity to be, to be threatened on solvency or any other governance issue. So for monitoring purpose, they have a temporary requirement of a watch list that they have. So moment you get into the watch list, even though it's temporary, such entity cannot go ahead with a debt issue. They need to resolve the watch list issue first, and then they have to issue their new debt security. Okay. So now these, remember, these four are there irrespective of the entity, but eligibility differs. Let me again summarize it for you, because so many students confuse these two, and there had been questions on these eligibility criteria in our past papers as well. I don't think the suggested answer was very elaborate on it in the first place, but understand, if you're just studying through the past papers, that's why your knowledge and your passing will also be threatened. Remember, financial markets are regularly updated. Okay, so read up. If you're self-studying or something, you have to read up more and research more. Understand, if it's a government entity or a public corporation, because it's a government entity, the basic expectation is they need a guarantee. Okay, guarantee from three entities: Government of Sri Lanka, or it's a bank. But if it's a bank, what do they want? It has to be licensed by CBSL. Not that alone, they also need to have an A rating. Other is, it has to be an international, multilateral, or a bilateral agency who is willing to guarantee on both the capital and interest repayment. Any of these three can give that irrevocable and unconditional guarantee. If not, the debt security that you're getting listed on, your issuing, has to have a rating of an investment grade. If so, that particular government entity can go ahead with the debt security issuance. But what becomes when it's a private company? The main requirement is the security has to be rated. And that's an and, remember, it's an and condition. It has to be rated, and that rating has to be one notch above the investment grade. And if these two are satisfied, then if you want, if that entity wants, at their own discretion, they could go in for a guarantee. Again, that has to be unconditional and irrevocable. But here, it will be the same three that that CSC would want the guarantee from. But remember, because it's a private, there is no relationship with the government of Sri Lanka. So it has to be either the bank licensed by CBSL and A rated, or an international, multilateral, or bilateral agency who's willing to guarantee on both the capital and interest repayment. Okay, so I hope that clears up. So then we move on to this default board that we discussed just when we were talking about the watch list. Now, this is not a separate listing board. Okay. if the question asks you what are the bonds available for a company to be listed in the stock exchange, remember there are four. But what default board does is it's a board where already listed entities, that particular company is already listed in the stock exchange, but if they are violating any requirement of the CSC, or if they are non-compliance to any CSC listing requirements, then they will be transferred to the default board. So what are the common violations that you can see? They are failing to report their annual report on time. They are failing to submit their financial statements on time. Those are the two main common issues. Okay. So if the relevant security, or if the particular share stays in excess of 1 month in default board, the CSC has the right to issue a press release with the consultation with the SEC to the public explaining the nature of violation, why it has been put on default board, and they can, because it's for the investors. Remember, it's already listed entity, so there'll be already investors holding that particular share. So they need to put out a press release explaining the nature of the violation. And if it exceeds 3 months, then they can refer the matter to SEC for further actions. Whether the company has to be continuously kept in the CSC or not, they could refer it to the SEC for the necessary action. Remember that watch list is just a temporary requirement. Now, if you look into the stock exchange currently, you can see so many companies. Now, remember, because of this corona or the COVID issue that impacted last week of March and it went on till May. So the basic requirement is from a quarter end. So ideally the March end quarter, within 45 days, you need to release your quarterly financial statements, unaudited, of course, but within 45 days, you need to issue your interim financial statements. But I have now, if you can really monitor the notices, you can see so many companies, they're explaining that they actually took a longer time to see extension of timeline to present the annual report. So these, they say that they've got permission to do it and they have to disclose why. Failure to which they can get transferred to watch list and then eventually to the default board. Now here you can see so due to this reason, they are unable to present it by the given deadline. So they are answerable. Okay, so they need to disclose the reason to avoid being transferred into the watch list and the default board. So many companies have come through it. Certain very good companies have still managed to put out all their annual reports on time and the interims on time, which is very, very noteworthy. Shows how the company is effectively run. Okay, so if you look into it at the moment, so many companies are issuing such kind of explanation to their shareholders. Then we move on to the price indices in the Colombo Stock Exchange. Now last week we saw stock indices or stock indexes in broader terms. Why do we need an index? What are the types of index available and how the calculation works? Now we are going to look into, in our stock exchange, what are the indices available to monitor the movement in the Colombo Stock Exchange. So we know moment you get into the stock exchange, the notable very first things that you see is the ASPI index and the S&P SL 20. So we are going to see what these two are specifically. So we have all share price index. That's what ASPI stands for. It is a market capitalization weighted index. Now, when I say that, you can understand what it does. Last week, when we went through the calculation, we did that elaborately. So when I say ASPI is a market capitalized weighted index, you know the method of calculation, where the weight of any company is taken as the number of ordinary shares listed in the stock market, and it incorporates all voting on ordinary shares. So here you can see it only incorporates the voting ordinary shares in the CSE. Okay, remember, in the price index it doesn't take the number of shares, only in the market capitalization the number of shares are being counted in. The current ASPI value is the broadest and the longest measure of the level of Sri Lankan Stock Exchange, because since I think 1985 is the base year, so since then it shows the movement in. Okay, so that's why it's the longest measure available in our stock exchange. As explained above, ASPI is valuated index based on the market capitalization, where the weight of any company is taken as the number of ordinary shares listed in the market. Here specifically, remember, the ordinary share is the voting ordinary shares. This weighting system allows the price movement of larger companies to have a greater impact on the index. This was one of the merits as to why we moved from a price index, price weighted index, to a market capitalized index. Remember, because price weighted index did not factor whether the company is large or small. As long as the price was big, the it was enough to influence the index. But when you move to the market capitalization, it allowed for larger companies to influence the index or to have a greater impact on the index. ASPI indicates the price fluctuations of shares of all listed companies and covers all the traded shares of companies during a market day. So at one particular market day, whatever the available market capitalization or the last traded market last traded price is what is used in the ASPI calculation. The main requirement is it is all listed companies, and it's weighted using market capitalization weighted index, and it is one of the longest and the more broadest index available in our stock exchange. So here I think when you move on to indices, you can see, and you can download as well. All the available details and the prices of the last traded and the shares available for your calculations. Then you have the S&P Sri Lanka 20, Standard and Poor's Sri Lanka 20. Now, what does this cover? By just looking at this itself, you can see this particular index is more, it's higher comparatively to this. So you can see there is a basic difference in these two indices, and we are going to see why. Now, Standard and Poor's Sri Lanka 20 covers only the largest and the most liquid stocks of the Sri Lankan equity market. Okay, now that's the difference between ASPI and S&P SL 20. ASPI covers all shares of the stock exchange, but here it has to be the largest and the most liquid stocks. Okay, this index has came about as a replacement of this Sri Lanka price index. Earlier there was an index called MPI, Sri Lanka price index, and that was replaced by the S&P SL 20 from 1st January 2013. So MPI was discontinued from this particular day. From there on, what we had was the S&P SL 20. Now here again, the main criteria for stock selection is the market capitalization, but what they're looking at is the float adjusted market capitalization. Now here we looked at just market capitalization, but here it has to be float adjusted or the free float adjusted. Remember what was free float? We discussed it last week. It has to be non-promoter held shares used for the index calculation. Why? If a promoter or a founder holds the share, those are shares not available for trading for one particular day. Those are not freely tradable. They hold it for ownership purposes. Therefore, such are removed from the calculation when you calculate the free float adjusted market capitalization. So the stocks that you are going to use here should have a free float adjusted market capitalization of above 500 million. Okay, so as of your rebalancing day, now there will come about what the rebalancing date is, but this is the statutory or the mandatory requirement for you to be eligible to fall into this index. Okay, so here you can see it covers mainly 20 companies. So the 20 companies should fall into this particular category. To be eligible for inclusion, the stock should have these criteria. Now for ASPI, it was not, as basically if it was listed in the stock exchange and it had ordinary voting shares available, it was included in the index. But here, your minimum float adjusted has to be 500 million rupees. And the 6-month median daily value traded, the daily value traded has to be at least 250,000, okay, 0.25 million. Have been traded in at least last 10 days of each, at least 10 days of each month for the 3 months prior to the rebalancing date. And it has a positive net income over 12 months prior to the rebalancing date. Now you'll be wondering what this rebalancing date is. Now what S&P does is, remember, all share price index, there was no issue in selecting. Okay, as long as it was there in the stock exchange and it has ordinary voting shares, it's there in the ASPI. But when it comes to S&P, remember, it has to be largest and the most liquid stock. Therefore, you have to select such stocks. So how frequently are you going to select is an important question when it comes to S&P SL20. Are you going to revisit the list every year, or are you going to revisit every 6 months? Okay, now usually earlier what they had was annually. Now they're looking into bi-annually, every 6 months. End of the 6 months, the stock exchange will evaluate whether the companies under the S&P SL20 are in fact eligible to be under that, and whether there are other companies who are qualified to get into the index. Okay, so that's why they call it the rebalancing or the rebalancing reference date. So we have 30th June for that and 31st December. At that particular date, that particular stock should have a free float adjusted market capitalization of 500 million. The 6 months, so within that period, 6 months median daily value traded has to be at least 0.25 million. And 10 days of each month for the 3 months prior to the rebalancing date. So if it's June, you will have June, May and April. In these 3 months, at least for 10 days in each month, it has to be traded. If it's the December rebalancing date, it has to be December, November and October that we're looking at. In these 3 months, at least 10 days of each month, whether it is rebalanced. Then you have positive net income over the 12 months prior to the rebalancing date. So if you're looking at December, Jan to December, the 12 months, whether it has a positive net income. If you're looking at June, from this year June to the last year July beginning, from there onwards, whether it has a positive net income. So all these four helps to see whether the company is the largest stock and it's the most liquid. How they know it's liquid is by these two criteria. Actually these three, when you have a minimum float adjusted meaning, then there are so much of shares available for public trading. And they see the 6 months daily value traded, whether it's frequently traded in the market. And they also measure whether it's traded in the last 3 months for at least 10 days. Okay, so all these three shows whether it's a liquid stock available. Now, if you were looking into news, you would have seen these listings where now this was last year, December. So here you can see from the current as of 31st December when they were reviewing, whatever in the list, they have excluded these three companies because they have been disqualified, and they have included three companies because they have been qualified. Okay, so you can see it has to be the 20 largest companies. So here you have the list of 20, the updated 20, and this was, I think, other than a release as of 20th December, at the end of December, that they're looking at. So this is the, if you can see, this list become effective from 23rd December 2019. But when was it released? On the 20th December. So days before, I think probably on a Friday that they issue it. So from Monday, it starts getting included. So on Friday, they issue the particular list of what companies will get out from this particular index and what companies will get into the index. Now, this is as of December. Let's see what happened this year, June. So you can see this year, June, again, on the 20th or the Friday closer to that, you can see these companies are excluded from the present listing. And then these companies get included in the S&P SL20. Now, you don't need to know what 20 companies are available. Just understand the requirements and the nature of the companies to be included in the S&P SL20. Okay, so these six were excluded and six were included. I think that's repeated again here. So you have the latest 20 that is being considered in the S&P SL20. Remember, earlier it was done annually, and from recent it was made to a semi-annual rebalance. See, previously it was conducted annually, but now it's a semi-annual practice. And again, I want you to note this one. Before they are actually included, the stock exchange issues the announcement. Okay, here you can see the announcement is made on June 19th, and this becomes effective, or they will get added and removed on a later date, the next, probably on Monday, the 22nd June. Okay, why I want you to note that is when we talk about certain market manipulations today, I will explain it to you why it's important. Okay, so and remember, it's a semi-annual rebalancing that is done to S&P SL20. Any no doubts. So these two, remember, are the price index available. Now, doesn't mean it's a price weighted index, but these are the price related. Remember, they both considers market capitalization, price weighted, or even free float. All of these measure the price or the trading price of it. Okay, I'm not talking about the weighted. These are the price indices available in our stock exchange. We also have return indices in our stock exchange. Now, you'll be wondering what these return indices are. Okay, let's look into that. These were introduced in 2004. Total return indices are calculated daily in addition to the price indices. The TRI reflects returns due to both price changes and dividend income. Now, this is important. What price indices does is it looks into the price changes. Okay, whether the price has increased or decreased, you can see through the index. But what the TRI or total return index does is they look at the return. Now remember, when you're a shareholder, what are the two ways that you can earn a return? Dividend or capital gains. Remember? So your TRI or the return will have both the price and your dividend issued being included in the index. So TRI is a better measure of returns from an investor perspective. So when you look at the TRI index, it will show you the returns earned by the stock exchange. In computing the TRI, we assume the dividends earned from a share are reinvested in the market. So if you get a dividend, they assume that it is reinvested in the market, and that's why they include it into the index calculation. So ASPI, S&P, SL20 and sector indices are published daily in terms of total returns. Now, what I want you to focus is all these three. Now you have ASPI and S&P SL20 looking into the price. The same basis you also have for TRI. If you are looking at all companies listed in the stock exchange and they are voting ordinary shares, but not only looking at price but also return, then the ASPI gets reworded as all share total return index. Now here it was price, this becomes total return index, but the basis is the same. Okay, so that's why I have mentioned here it can be the all share, S&P SL20 and even sector wise indices. So you know what sector, the return you earn for each sector. Okay, these are published daily in terms of total returns as well. For ASPI, if it is calculated based on total returns, it is called all share total return index. All right, this is important. ASTRI is different from ASPI. Here it's price, here we are looking at total return index. Then we are moving on to the global industry classification standard. Now let's get into the stock exchange and see. Now when you move to the stock exchange, we saw how do we know whether how the stock exchange has moved up or not, move up or move down? You look at the two indices that will indicate us whether the market has, whether it's a bear market or a bull market. Those calls are being done through the how the indices are reacting. Now we are going to look at the classifications. Now we know so many companies. Now here you can see, as of 30th June, you have 289 companies listed who fall into several sectors. Okay, there can be different sectors for companies. Now you will be wondering, because as an investor, if you are looking into a particular sector and you know certain sector is doing well, you will want to increase your share exposure or your stock exposure to that particular sector. Now if you recall from 2011 onwards, we had about a construction boom. So many the construction sector was expanding. So at that point of time, so many investors had a higher exposure to the construction companies or the construction sector companies. All right. So for you to know how that sector is doing well, whether to focus any other companies in the sector, you need to have a sector classification. Okay. So that's why you have these GICS classification in the stock exchange. Now what is GIS? GIS is the Global Industry Classification Standard. okay, and that is developed by Morgan and Stanley Capital and Standard and Poor's. These two entities have joined together and developed this particular standard, and it's a global industry classification. Irrespective of the country, they would, if they're using this particular classification, the sectors are standard. So as an investor, especially as a global investor or a foreign investor, it's easy for you to compare the sectors. Okay, so this is like a standard sector classification available globally. So GICS classifications aim to enhance the investment research and asset management process for financial professionals worldwide. It was designed in response to financial community's need for accurate, complete, and standard industry definition. Now, this was one of the main reasons why they needed the GICS. Because imagine yourself as an investor in, let's say, UK. So UK has GICS, and you're interested in getting to the Sri Lankan Stock Exchange as well. So there you have construction entity, construction companies, you have the particular sector to look at. Now here, when you get into it, this particular country has a different definition for construction. So here you have not only construction companies, any other companies who are remotely even doesn't fall into that sector being included, it will distort your comparison. Okay, so to avoid such scenarios and to promote the country's stock exchange, see, we are of global standard. We have adopted the global requirements. For you to enhance the image of the stock exchange as well is why we as a country have moved into the GICS standard. All right. The classification aims to provide an accurate, complete, and long-term view of the global investment universe from an industrial perspective. Now, hold on. Now, under GICS structure, you have 11 sectors, 24 industry groups, 69 industries, and 148 sub-industries. Now you will be confused saying, what is this? Okay, let me explain that. Now this I was able to get off from the GICS website itself. Let me put it on read mode for you. So if you can Google or type the entire word, you'll be able to get this document as well. So there they talk about how the GICS classification is structured. Now you don't have to get into the nitty-gritty of how it is structured. Just understand what GICS stands for. That is very, very important. It's a possible MCQ question for you. I will explain you why. And then what are the benefits of adopting GICS classification for our country and as an investor? From these two point of view, what is the benefit for you? And then the salient features of this method. Now here you can see you have four groups. You have four broader categories. The main category is the sector. So under the sector, you have an industry group. That industry group is broken down into industry, and then you have sub-industry. Okay, that's how it works. Let's take this. This is more easier for you because all the others had one industry group. When you look at this particular industry, consumer discretionary. Okay, discretionary. Now here, that is the sector. All right, and then you have industry group. Under this sector, you have two industry groups. This is the main one. These are the initial breakdowns. So under these two, so you have automobile and components, and then you have consumer durables and apparel. then again this industry group is broken down to industry. So you can see auto components are one industry, automobile is a separate industry. Here also you have consumer durables and apparels. You can see how they have broken it down. Household durables, I hope you can see it. Household durables is one industry. And then you have leisure products. Sorry. You have leisure products as another. And then you have textile, apparel, and luxury goods as a another one. Now here you have another category as well called consumer services industry group. There also you have hotels and restaurants as one industry and diversified consumer services as another industry. So broadly you can see how one sector, one particular sector is classified in so many industry groups, and each industry group is then broken down into a particular industry. Okay. So now consumer discretionary is one very broad category. So let's take one. So under automobile, because it's a very easy example. So under consumer discretionary, you have automobile and components that is broken down into automobile auto components one and automobiles later. And that again is broken down into another subcategory. Now here, when you say just automobile, it can be automobile manufacturers and can include motorcycle manufacturers. Now these two are two different sectors and they explain you what, why here. So they have a specific definitions. So here bicycles are excluded. These are just examples for you to understand it, okay? So they have separate definitions for these sub-industries. So when you go to components, you have tire and rubber as a separate component, and then you have parts. When you have automobile parts, remember tires or rubber related is a separate component, and any other accessory as another separate sub-industry. So that's how elaborate this GICS classification is. It has a vast classification, helps us to understand and categorize that particular company at the right sector. Okay. If not, you can have any discrepancies in the sector classification. So that's why it says it has 11 sectors, 24 industry groups, 69 industries, and 158 sub-industries. How it works is this. You have Apex. Let's take this. Oops. So how it works is this is the topmost sector is broken down into industry group, it is broken down to industries, and then you have sub industries. But remember, overall GICS has 11 sectors. It addresses, looks into 11 sectors, and it is so broad, it has 158 sub industries for us to look at, because these two can be the testing area. So you have understand they broadly look into 11 broad sectors, and the classification is so broad enough that 11 sectors are subsequently broken down into 158 sub industries. Okay. GICS methodology assigns each company to a sub industry and to a corresponding industry group, sector according to the definition of its principal business activity. So for GIS, how the classification begins is from a bottom up. They first assign to a sub-industry, then the industry group, and a particular sector. C since this classification is strictly hierarchical at each since the classification is strictly hierarchical at each of the four levels, a company can only belong to one particular grouping. Okay, now that is important. It is strictly hierarchical, so it can be only one particular grouping that it has. Now, what are the features when it comes to GICS structure? Now, GICS is a universal structure. It applies to companies globally, exchanges globally, and it is accurate. The structure is accurate enough to reflect the state of industries across the equity investment universe. So what they're meaning is across the exchange, it has an accurate representation. And it also is flexible. Why do we call it flexible? It has 158 sub-industries for you to pick and choose on. So elaborate, so definitely, so elaborate on that. And it also have four different levels for you to look at. So it starts from a more general sector to a very specified sector. From 11 sectors, it drills down to 158 sub-industries. Okay, so that's why you call it flexible. You start off from a very general and you get into a more specified. It allows any company to get easily listed or chosen into a particular sector. Then it is also evolving. Continuous annual reviews are done by MCEI, MCI, MSCI, and Standard & Poor's. These two were the developers of the method, so they continuously do annual reviews to ensure that the structure is not outdated and it's frequently clear and accurate. Therefore, it's evolving. Based on annual reviews, they change the structure and classification, so the structure and the method is updated at all times. So how does GIS classification impact us? So our stock exchange, the Colombo Stock Exchange, adapted the GICS classification at the start of 2016. How it began is, I'm just explaining to you the story. They started it off as a pilot run. We already had a classification in our stock exchange, but in addition to that, they also had the GICS running parallelly. Why? Because our fund managers, analysts are already accustomed to one set of sector classification. Therefore, to make the transition smooth, they were running both classification parallelly. The existing or the previous classification and the GIS classification from 2016. But from the beginning of this year, or from the 20th January onwards, they discontinued our earlier category and now we are full on into the GICS category classification. Okay, I do have a slide on our, just to show you on our previous and current classification. So our previous classification was, we had a broader category on banking and finance. So you have both the companies, it can be a main board or a divisavi board under that. Then you have just beverage, food and tobacco. Then you have chemical and pharmaceutical, closed-ended fund, construction, diversified holdings, footwear and textile. So these were just the broader category that are available for just for us to look at. Investment trust, land and property. So these were the broader segments that we had. I'm trying to show you that there were some shortcomings in our earlier category because certain companies were better representative in a separate segment, but still it went ahead and it was under a very different sector. Let's see whether I could note it. So these were the broad sectors. Now this was from a database that we maintained where we track all the earnings when we were at the when we look when we were under the when I was operating as a under a stock brokering group. So these were the sector classification, the broader ones that we had. I recall we had some very funny companies being recorded into very funny sectors. See here you had footwear and textiles both into one. So you had leather products were different from textile, but both are being plugged into one particular sector. Now, and here it was much different. Now, Odell was a more retailer at the moment, but still it is under the textile industry. Now, this particular, now it's called as Haley's Fabric. Haley's Fabric is a textile manufacturing company. Odell PLC was a more retailing agency, but even though the it was cloth, or the common thing they had was maybe apparel that you can look at, but you know, need on a specified basis, they are doing two different businesses, but still it was grouped under one particular classification. Then we had GICS, so here you can see you had the sector, then the classification, retailing specifically, consumer services specifically. So you can see under retailing, we had separately Odell PLC coming under that. So these were the, you know, just because it has 158 subcategories doesn't mean we need to have at least one company under each. Remember, we had only 289 companies listed in our stock exchange. So we might not use all sub industry categories, but it was more granular level, so that it was a better representative than what we had earlier. So these, and we had food stapling and retailing separately, because earlier, if I can recall, Cargill's were and all at a very different. So it was broadly under this. It was food, even though if it's food, beverage or tobacco, it was just in one. But now you can see it is under consumer staples, but it's not a food and beverage tobacco alone. Now it's under retailing, food retailing segment, a more specified segment for them. So energy separately. So under energy, there was no any other specified granular level for us to go. But here, if you can recall, under energy, we had so much of companies being listed. So here you, because it had power and energy. So even though if it's like a hydropower, the power generation entities were also included in it. So it was, even though the sector is power and energy, understand the businesses that they were doing were different. Here it was more representative, energy alone. So in, you can understand how much granular level that they have gone with. Now here you can see it was sector was just financial. So you have diversified financials separately, you have banks separately. So that much of a classification is available. Insurance separately, and then real estate companies separately. But here it was all in one. Bank, finance, insurance, it was entirely in one pool. Here it is under one big pool, but the subcategories are more specified. Okay. So what were the advantages of moving to GIS? The use of this global standard helps foreign investors to compare easily our companies with their entities or their sectors available. Then GICS enables fund managers and investment research community to make comparison by industry very easily, because for one definition it's being grouped, therefore you the matching of the two entities is very, very easy. Now if you are looking into a USA, a stock exchange apparel sector, and if you had earlier footwear and textile in our local market, the comparison is different. But now classifications are same, the basis of classification is same, so you can easily compare and see whether the market has potential to grow or move or not. So easily you can make such informed decision by looking at that. Then also GICS helps market participants determine whether stock performances are locally based or a part of broader global trend. So here this one is where we could look at whether a particular sector is depending on a global trend, it's moving up or not. So if you have apparel sector, if a particular country's apparel sector is moving up or the retailing of apparel is moving up, you can see if the manufacturing outsourced to us, our sector index should also be moving up. So those kind of inform or the relationship is evident to us. Okay. So with that, we will be concluding our last week lecture series on the CSE. So understand the specific, now entire this slide is dedicated to our local market and our local requirements and requirements available. Okay, so this week we are going to see the governing entity of the Colombo Stock Exchange. Now remember this diagram. Hopefully that will get copied. So remember this particular diagram. So under this diagram, where does Security Exchange Commission falls is at this level. Let's take white. So governing the Colombo Stock Exchange, we have the SEC. Okay, so frequently you all have questions on who are the entities or the structure of our equity market. This is the structure of our equity market. You have Securities and Exchange Commission overlooking and regulating the stock exchange. You have Colombo Stock Exchange, which is the only stock exchange of Sri Lanka. And then you have CDS and CSC Clear giving us two separate supporting services at the CSC. Okay, so this is the entire structure. So far, we've looked into this broadly and the roles of these two. So today, our focus is on this. What is their role and why are they there for us? Okay. So CSC, remember, it's Securities and Exchange Commission of Sri Lanka. Why do we need Securities and Exchange Commission? Why do we need regulation in our stock exchange? If you can recall the second YouTube video I sent you, in the past, when the stock exchange was evolving or being developed, there were so many incidents where the brokers have manipulated investors, brokers have cheated investors, misled them to wrong stocks. Those have damaged the stock exchange or the stock market as a whole, impacted the confidence of the investors on the market. If you talk to a person, you can see they would say, oh, stock exchange, we don't want to get into it. We've already burnt the finger, we don't want to get into it. So that kind of a negative attitude. So for you to go past that, to ensure that the investors are protected, ensure that the stock investor confidence is not affected, is why you have a Securities and Exchange Commission available regulating the market. A well-regulated market has the potential to encourage additional investors to contribute and furthering the development of the economy. CSC is a statutory body set up by the government to regulate and oversee the capital market. The Securities and Exchange Commission of Sri Lanka was established under the CSE Act number 36 of 1985, and there were subsequent amendments, but understand this is the base act. The Incorporation Act is 36 of 1984. Could be a possible MCQ, so that's why I'm just telling you, note on the number. It was amended subsequently by three times in 1991, 2003 and 2009, just for you to know. Amended subsequently, and CSE, Securities and Exchange Commission, is the regulator of the capital market in Sri Lanka. So what was the reason of incorporating or establishing a Security Exchange Commission? The mission or the reason why they were established is to promote, develop and maintain a capital market that is fair, efficient, orderly and transparent. Now this itself tells you their duty. They are obliged or they are dutiful to promote the capital market, to develop the capital market and to maintain the capital market. You can see our Securities and Exchange Commission going on road shows, promoting our stock exchange, requesting investors to enter into our stock exchange and invest. So the promotional aspect of it. And then you have develop. Remember, they launch new products for you, different sector codes for you. They develop the current stock exchange, so it is up to date and investor friendly, global investor friendly, if I'm specific. Okay. And then also maintain the regularity, maintain, avoid any collapses and whatnot. Okay. So three requirements. Now all these three are looking at the capital market so that the capital market is fair. It's not fair for just one party, fair for all investors. All investors have equal opportunity there. Then it is efficient. If the speedness of the transaction, how effective of it, the efficiency of the stock market. And then it operates in an orderly manner. It's a formal structure, not an informal structure. It's the orderly component. And the market is transparent. Transparency is important for fairness, because if it's transparent, all investors are informed. Moment where the transparency is affected is where you have any market manipulations coming in. Okay. So remember, this is the basic mission of the Securities and Exchange Commission. The role itself is to maintain efficient, transparent and effective markets. That's why you have a CSE. CSE oversees the involvement and operations of organizations and individual investors. Now, this is important. Why I'm classifying is, now, just because they are available to protect and ensure investor confidence doesn't mean that they only oversee the investors. They also oversee the organizations that are listed in the stock exchange. Remember, when we discussed on default board, we said if it's in the default board for more than 3 months, the Colombo Stock Exchange will refer the matter to SEC for further action. So that will tell you. SEC also involves when it comes to the listed entities. Why? Moment a listed entity goes bad or collapses, it affects the stock exchange, affects the investor confidence. Therefore, they also look into the organizations, the listed organizations, the stock brokers, the stock exchanges. Our country, we only have only one stock exchange. If you have multiple, they look into the stock exchanges, the research companies and market intermediaries, the rating agencies. They oversee the entire market. All right. Remember, in the very first lecture, we had the diagram. I hope you all can recall the very first lecture. If so, it's very, very good. So first you had the excess units, and then you had the deficit units and so on. If you can just have a look at the slide. So here you had the direct market, then you had financial intermediaries over here. This was financial markets. You had another area where you can go through this, and they will come to this. Let's say deficit. This is excess. So this was one where you go through the financial intermediary, or the financial intermediary can come to the financial market and then go to the deficit unit, or you can directly go to the deficit unit through this way, which is the third method. Now I said entire arrangement is overseen by financial market regulation. Okay, so that is where you have SEC arranging on it. SEC looks into the investors, the company. Here you have the investors. I'm talking in terms of a stock exchange or the stock market. You have investors. Here would be your stock exchange. This would be the listed companies. Financial intermediary could be the investment banks, the rating agencies, all the support agencies. So the CSE looks into all of them. So what is the importance of the SEC? Main is that available for protection of the investors. Okay, that is one of the, if you look into the major objectives, which we will go through, this is the objective of the Securities and Exchange Commission as per the Act. So there you can see, one of their objective is to protect the interest of the investors. So that itself becomes why it is important for us to have a SEC in our markets. Then to maintain efficient, orderly and transparent market. If you want, you can add fair as well. Remember here, fair, efficient, orderly and transparent market. And to enhance investor confidence. We already know that. You protect investors from market manipulation, that itself would help to enhance investor confidence. Then, not only safeguarding investors, they are also duty bound to develop the capital market. That is also one why we have a Securities and Exchange Commission. They look into the latest market developments, issue the new products that other capital market has, the same standards of other capital markets. Now you can see why we moved into GICS and so many new products, so many new boards coming in. And they also address certain issues like smaller scale entities wants to get into the stock exchange. They have a separate board. So all those are examples of how they develop the stock capital market. Then they also are there to prevent market irregularities. That is also one of the important features or duties of a SEC. So what does this Securities and Exchange Commission, that particular commission, the board of it, who are the board members overseeing the Securities and Exchange Commission? So we have 10 non-executive members, 10 non-executive members who are looking into it, and they contribute to the policy making arm of the SEC. So they are the ones who broadly set the policies for the Securities and Exchange Commission. So remember, you have 10 individuals here. So this becomes something like a monetary board. Monetary board has 5 members, remember? So here you have, here you have 10. Let's see how that 10 is comprised of. So you have broadly 2 ways. Now here you have 10 members. you have 7 coming in from one type and 3 coming in from another type. Okay, so 3 are ex officio members. That means moment they are appointed to these roles, if a person is appointed to this particular role, then by default they become members of the SEC. Okay, that's why you call ex officio members. If you become registrar of company, that becomes, because you are registrar of company, you become a member of the commission. Okay, that's why you call it ex officio. All right, so you have 3 people who get appointed in that basis. You have the DST, you have the deputy secretary of to the treasury, registrar of companies, and the president of the Institute of Chartered Accountants. These 3 members are appointed as ex officio members. Moment they get elected for this role, they get this particular role as well. Okay, then you have another 7. Another 7 are not based on ex officio members. Another 7 are appointed by the Minister of Finance. Now that is important. Here, these are appointed members, and these 3 are ex officio members. Nobody has to come and appoint them. As long as they get that posting, they become the member of the commission as well. But here, you have to get appointed by the Minister of Finance. So who can get appointed by the Minister of Finance? 6 people from the private sector who has the professional expertise and the experience and the proven competency level in finance, law and banking and business. Okay, so 6 people from the private sector. So it can be anyone, there is no particular post that person has to hold, as long as they are from the private sector and they have the professional and the wide experience in these sectors, the Minister of Finance can appoint them. The other one is the Deputy Governor of CBSL. Now remember, this doesn't fall into ex officio member. I'll explain you why. Just because you are a deputy governor of CBSL, you don't automatically get appointed to the SEC. Okay, there can be 10 deputy governors. Okay, or more. Now usually I think it's about 4 or 5 at current moment. So there can be any number of deputy governors, but just because you become a deputy governor, you don't automatically become a member of the commission. A deputy governor who gets nominated by the governor of the CBSL. A particular deputy governor has to get nominated by the governor. Then that nominated entity will be appointed by the Minister of Finance. That is important. That's why they don't fall into the ex officio member list. Ex officio members are deputy secretary to the treasury, registrar of companies, president of the Institute of Chartered. Okay, moment you get this posting, automatically you become members of the SEC. Okay, so that's how the split works. Now, who becomes the chairman out of these 10? The Minister of Finance shall nominate 1 member. So who has the discretion to appoint it is the Minister of Finance. Every appointed member of the commission shall hold office for a term of 3 years and shall be eligible for reappointment. So each member who gets chosen under this can serve for 3 years and is eligible for reappointment. It's for 3-year period and is eligible for reappointment. So understand that. Know that it's 10 members. Out of the 10, 3 are ex officio members. Who are the 3? DST, registrar and president of chartered. Then you have appointed by the finance minister. Another 7 were appointed by the minister. 6 are from the private sector. 1 is a deputy governor from CBSL, but that particular deputy governor has to be nominated by the governor first. Okay. Then what are the objectives of the SEC? So as per the act, now I think the act, I have uploaded the act as well. So this particular PDF has the base act and includes all the subsequent amendments. Now I don't ask you to study the entire act, but in case if you want to refer anything that you are unsure of, you can always refer to the base act, which will have all the relevant provisions. So as per that particular act, these are the objectives for which the SEC is established. Okay. So main objective is to create and maintain a market where securities can be issued and traded in an orderly and fair manner. Now let's break it down. Main objective is first, they're talking about creation. To create and to maintain the market, okay, where securities can be issued. So here they're talking about a more primary market and traded. So it's a secondary market as well. So that the trade happens orderly and a fair manner. This is their main objective. Then, protection of the interest of investors. Now, this is an easy objective for you to remember. One of the sole reasons as to why the SEC is established. Okay. And then what do you have? You have operation of a compensation fund. Now, this is important. I'll explain you why. When we talk about the funds, now in our slide, there is a separate section where we talk about the funds maintained by the SEC. So there are three funds maintained by the SEC: compensation fund, settlement guarantee fund, and the SES fund. Out of these three, the fund that is mentioned as their objective is the compensation fund. Okay, remember that. So compensation fund, where they are to operate the compensation fund so that you can protect investors from financial loss arising as a result of any stock broker, stock dealer found incapable of meeting their contractual obligation. Okay, so you SEC is there to operate this particular fund so that it will be there to protect the investors. That's another one. The fourth objective is regulation of the securities market and to ensure that professional standards are maintained in such markets. So these four are the main objectives. Now I've seen always these four will definitely get involved in some way or another in your exam. So remember the four specifically. One is create and maintain a market so that the security you create and you maintain the market so that the securities which are issued and the traded can happen orderly and fairly. Okay. Other one is you're protecting the interest of the investors. Third is you operate the compensation fund so you're it's there to protect the investors from financial loss due to a broker or a dealer not being able to discharge their obligation. So that happens is if a broker or a dealer fails on their part to protect the investor, you have the compensation fund. Lastly, you regulate the stock exchange so that it is up to professional standard. Okay, these four are the main of the only objectives of the SEC as per the act. then you have the powers and duties. Now these are the objectives of the SEC. For the SEC to discharge these objectives or to achieve these objectives, they need to have certain powers, they have certain duties and functions to do. Okay, now there are several powers, duties and functions as per the act. Okay, the first slide has the important 6 powers, and then the ancillary powers and duties go on. So there are 3 slides mentioning that. So each of the function we'll look into it. Okay, and we'll see an easy way that you all can remember it. I am unable to mark on the slide, so therefore I have to move to PowerPoint. Okay, so here, first we are going to look at these 4. Now there's a very easy way for you to remember these first 4 powers, duties and the function. Okay, the SEC has the power to give a license and to register. Okay, now that's important. And to register. And that's what we're looking at in the first 4. So the SEC has the power to grant license. To what entities? An entity who is willing to operate as a stock exchange. Entity who is willing to operate as a stock broker or a stock dealer. Entity who is a managing company to operate a unit trust. So for these 3, or if I'm saying these 4, broker and dealers, I'm breaking it. Then for these 4, they have the power to give license, to grant a license. Okay, so that becomes the first set of powers: issue license to operate a stock exchange, to operate as a stock exchange, then to operate as a stock broker or a stock dealer, and also to operate as a managing company of a unit trust. Then remember, they can also register. Who can they register? They can grant certificate of registration to market intermediaries. Now that is important. During the slide, we will see who are these market intermediaries, but broadly understand, if it's a market intermediary that we're looking at, it is certificate of registration. Okay, licenses, we're looking at stock exchange, stock broker, stock dealer and unit trust. If you know all these 4, that simply gives you the power and the duty. Then what do we have? So this is who can actually trade in the stock market. If they give the license, is where you will have a stock exchange for you to trade. If they give the license only, you will have the stock broker and the stock dealer. If they give the license only, a company can operate a unit trust. Okay, and if they give registration or certificate of registration, is where you have market intermediaries. All right, then we're looking at another set: to give general or specific directions. Now, to who can they give general or specific directions? To licensed stock exchange, licensed stock broker, stock dealer, managing company, or registered market intermediary. So here also you can see, to any of these 4, or specifically if I'm saying these 5: stock exchange, stock broker, stock dealer, unit trust, let's say managing company of unit trust, that's better, managing company of unit trust and market intermediary, the SEC has the powers to grant the license or to grant register certificate of registration, yes, and also to give general or specific directions. Okay, so all these five, stock exchange is one, licensed stock broker is another one, stock dealer is a third one, managing company or a trustee, so that is one criteria, let's say managing company or trustee of unit trust. And fifth is market intermediary who is registered. Okay, remember the word registered, they are not licensed, they are registered. So for them, SEC has the powers to give general or specific directions. And the other main one is, again, SEC has the powers to give general or specific directions to the listed public companies. Okay. So now, these six, you have an easy way to remember. If you can recall one particular aspect, the first one, you can easily break down into four powers. And even the other one, you can see here, you're looking at who can the SEC give instructions for or directions for. Whether it's specific or general, they can give it to listed public companies and list licensed stock exchange or a stock broker or a dealer or a managing company of a unit trust or a registered market intermediary. So these six you can easily remember. Then we move to the second set of it. Now, the second set of it, I want you to understand and remember in your head. There are certain powers and functions which is easy for you to remember. Those you can take, actually mention it when you're writing your answers. But understand why such powers are given to SEC. Now, other set is they can grant compensation to investor who suffers pecuniary loss. Here you're talking about the monetary loss arising as a result of any licensed stock broker or a dealer incapable of meeting the contractual obligation. So here, summary one of this is SEC can grant compensation using the compensation fund. Remember why the fund is available? Fund is available to protect the investor if the dealer or the broker is unable to discharge their duty. So that becomes their power itself. They are powerful enough. They have the powers to grant compensation to any investor as long as they follow a monetary loss. You can mention that within the bracket. As long as they may face a financial or a monetary loss that is quantifiable in financial terms, then they can use the compensation fund and pay for them. To advise the government on the development of the securities market. So if there are certain aspects where the market can develop on, they can advise the government as to how to develop it. They also have the power to employ people to carry out the work of the SEC. They also have the power to regulate the listing and the issue of securities in the exchange. They can regulate it by issuing fresh requirements. Okay, that's what they're talking about. The eligible requirement, they can always influence it. To direct a licensed stock exchange to reject the application made for listing. So even that particular power is with the SEC. They can regulate the listing of the company and the issue of securities. And they can also ask the stock exchange to reject any application for listing as well. They could also cancel and suspend the listing of any securities or the trading of a security or to suspend the trading of all securities for not more than three days at a time for the protection of investors. So remember, SEC has the power to cancel and suspend listing cancel and suspend trading of a particular security or to suspend the trading of all securities for the to protect the interest of the investors, but for not more than 3 days at one given time. That is important. To inquire and conduct investigations on the exchange, broker, the dealer, the licensed managing company of a unit trust, and the registered market intermediary, or even the public company or the listed company on any of their activity. The SEC has the power to inquire and investigate them. Okay. Other one is to publish findings of malfeasance, the wrongdoings of any broker, dealer, managing company of a unit trust, market intermediary, and listed company. So these two you can see are related. They have the power to investigate on all six, and they have power to publish the wrongdoings. But here it's important, stock exchange is not mentioned here. Okay, that is an important aspect. Stock exchange is not mentioned here. Stock exchange is they are regulating directly itself. Here, implement policies and programs of the government with respect to any market, the market of securities. They have powers to hold assets, lease, acquire. So this is very generic for their operational. They can ask the registrar of companies. Now here, they can request only, okay? They can request the registrar of the company to convert a private company to become a public company. They can request only. They don't have the power to command. They can make a request. And they also have the power to regulate takeovers and mergers. But remember, they can regulate the takeover and the merger as long as one of the companies is a listed entity. Okay. If it's a not listed entity, SEC cannot get involved into it. If it involves at least one listed public company, then the SEC has the power to involve into it. Now here you can see, if the merger is between one or more listed companies, they can involve, or where at least one party in that merger or the takeover is a listed company, they can involve. And the last one is to conduct investigations on any violation and any non-compliance relating to the SEC Act. If there's anyone who's violating it or not in compliant to it, they can conduct their investigations. Now this is derived from their powers or the functions. Licenses grant by the SEC. So we saw that before itself. Who can the SEC grant licenses for? Any body corporate who's willing to do the business of operating the stock exchange, be a stock broker or a stock dealer, operating a unit trust, then the commission, the company can make the application to the commission to get the license. So granting of license occurs to these four only. But registration, certificate of registration happens for these five market intermediaries. Now that's important. Remember, I said we'll discuss on who the market intermediaries are. You have five market intermediaries. These five market intermediaries are given a certificate of registration. That's why when we discussed on the debt listing, it says registered rating agencies under the SEC. That's why we mention it. The rating agency gets a certificate of registration. Okay, so these five will get a certificate of registration, or they become registered market intermediary. Now what these five does is a separate lecture series that I will have under the financial market service providers. So there we will in detailly go on what their particular role in the SEC. So anyway, I think time's up. So we will go through this in our next class. Like next week, I won't be having the lecture series. So week after that, we'll meet up and conclude this and move to the elaborate roles and functions on the these five market intermediaries. Meanwhile, if you can go through this lecture series as well, we'll get into the details on the next class. The next week, I won't be having it. The week after that. Okay. So I'll meet you all then. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you all are cleared on any aspects. So we'll see you on a next class. Thank you.